know what time it is? It's time to worship God. So welcome to Happy Hour at the world-famous Salvation Saloon's Water and Hole Church. Get ready to be blessed. So sit back, hang on, and enjoy the ride as we take you out of this crazy world and into a spirit-filled, life-changing gospel show service. Already in progress.
Well, here we are in New Year's. All of our Christmas crowd is gone. Oh, you know, Christmas and Easter, we just have to prepare for those. No, I think it's great. Everybody's here, everybody's having a good time, and that's what we want to do, right? We should have fun. We celebrate the Lord, don't you think?
Yes.
I think that's the way to do it.
Yes.
Change of pace. This is a song Bear came up with a while back. I've always loved this song. It's just so different, so meaningful. Not in your typical catalog of songs you hear in church.
No.
But I like it in this church. I like it a lot.
But he has a message, so.
It does have the right message. Yes, it does.
County cold. He messed up his back. He couldn't work anymore. He said, one of these days you get out of these hills. Keep your nose on the grindstone and out of the pills. See, the ways of this world will bring you to tears. Nothing to fear, live the best that you you can, and don't lie and don't steal. Keep your nose on the grindstone and eye the pills. Well, Daddy, I've been trying, I just can't catch a break. There's too much in this world I can't seem to fade. But I remember your words, Lord, they bring me the chills. Keep your nose on the grindstone and out of the pills. Takes twice as long to build bridges you've burned, and there's hurt you can cause, time alone cannot heal. Keep your nose on the grindstone and out of the pills. Well, Daddy, I've been trying, I just can't catch a break. There's too much of this world I can't seem to shake. But I remember your words, Lord, they bring me the chills. Keep your nose on the grindstone and out of the pills. Keep your nose on the grindstone.
Hey, Happy New Year, everyone. And welcome. Welcome to Happy Hour at the world-famous Salvation Saloon. And for those of you who may be here for the very first time, well, we always like to start our services out by letting you guys know we are so glad you guys are here. We truly believe God's going to bless you guys today. There is one thing that we would ask of you, though, if you don't mind. And that is if you just grab one of these little yellow cards that you see all over the place. And if you would, just throw your name in that. Tell us where you're from. That'd be cool. But then if you don't mind, if you just hold on to this card till the end of the service and write down the bottom in the comment section, tell us what you thought. We're always kind of curious. So if you do that, that would be great. But again, we are so glad you're here, and you're our guest from here on out. So sit back, hang on, enjoy the ride. We do have a couple other purposes for these cards, though, that everyone else knows about, and that is if there happens to be a birthday or an anniversary, it could be just about anything that you think we got to know about, well, you can put it on this card 1 week in advance. But the main reason we have these cards is for prayer. So if you're here and you have a need in your life, put that need down on this card and give God an opportunity to show himself strong, because prayer does work. Amen? Bible tells us this. Bible tells us that our God is a present help in times of trouble, but also tells us that sometimes we have not because we ask not. So put your needs down on this card. All right, well, here at the Salvation Saloon, we are a family. Like every family, we try to make sure we recognize each other. And by gory, I think we got a few saloontic birthdays, don't we, Rob?
Happy birthday to you.
All right. Happy birthday. And there is a game that we play each and every week, and that game is called Name That Saloonatic. Now, if you are here for the first time, just so you do know, we do call our congregation members Saloonatics, and every week we try to get a picture, usually an old picture. We throw it up and try to guess who it is. And anyways, see what you can do with this. See if you can guess who this Saloonatic is. Katie? That's not Bear. Carol. Suzanne. Any others? I say that because you guys didn't guess it. So let's, someone who says Pam? Pam Biagini? Well, let's find out. Will the real Saloonatic please stand up? And she's way in the back. It is Pam Biagini. I can see that. All right. Well, today I have absolutely nothing else to add. So on with the show we go. And let's get Katie up here. And she's going to pray God's blessing on the remainder of our service.
Good morning, everyone. Happy New Year. Thank you. I'm 35. Thank you. All right. I'd like to give a prayer for our offering. If you all can bow your heads, I'd appreciate it. That'd be great. Lord Jesus, thank you for the plans you have for us that are for our good and for your glory. You said, Lord, give and it will be given to you. For in the same measure that as you give, it'll be given to you again and again. We ask that you receive our offering and continue to supply all our needs. Please bless the gift and the giver. In your mighty name, Jesus, amen.
This is a song that I felt very moved to want to do this today. A lot of you folks, didn't start coming until after one of our brothers in Christ had gone home to be with the Lord, which is Buzzy. A lot of us love Buzzy. Buzzy was one of a kind. But for whatever reason, over this Christmas holiday season, he was really on my mind a lot. And I guess it's because, been gone a year. Just playing on my head. Well, this is one of Buzzy's signature songs. So I guess we'll dedicate this to him. What do you think?
Amen. Okay.
Walk to the garden, gotta watch your back. I beg your pardon, walk the straight and narrow track. If you walk with Jesus, he's gonna save your soul. You gotta get the devil way down in the hole.
Fire and the fury, and sliding.
Who is that?
Ducking and dodging. Running down alleys, hiding behind doorways and paper stands, the old news tracks, and busting anywhere he can find a hide because he's scared to death. But we all got to keep the devil way down in that dirty old rotten, stinking, nasty, dark hole.
Oh, thank you, Buzzy.
Thank you, Buzzy.
That was a cool surprise. Good job, Dave. All right. Well, we have survived yet another Christmas and another year. And so now, I guess we have 2023 to look forward to. But as that old Posse Band song says, this world is crazy, and it is getting crazier with each passing year. And so here we are, people. We're entering yet another year with COVID as a worldwide threat. But yet, isn't it kind of strange that despite all the restrictions and mandates that were meant to keep us isolated and apart, yet violence and lawlessness is still skyrocketed? Such as a homicide rate that has experienced its highest increase in recorded history, which has been fueled, as I think we all know, by all this social, racial, and political unrest that has our country divided like never before since the Civil War. And then we have a border crisis that's created multiple problems, like the free flow of the illegal drugs that are now entering our country, and now we have an overdose death rate that suddenly has risen by almost 600%. Then there's our economy, where we are entering this new year with an inflation rate that is higher than it's been in over 30 years. Food prices that we've seen food prices that have gone up over 30% in the last 2 years, and home rentals that are three times higher than that crazy inflation rate. Then we have a supply chain problem that has created some serious shortages in things like baby formula and important medications. And so right here in America, I mean, it's almost like we've become a third world country. And obviously I could go on and on and on. And again, that is just here, let alone all the things that are going on in the rest of the world, such as the invasion of Ukraine, where the threat of nuclear war has been mentioned numerous times. Anyways, I'm sure I've just depressed you all. But let's face it. Let's face it. The bottom line is the future is not very promising. But really, that shouldn't surprise us because biblical prophecy has predicted all of this. Amen? But here's the thing. Here's the thing. Despite all that, I am here this morning to let you know that God can still sustain and bless his people. And so, today as we enter into a new year, I thought it'd be kind of good for us to kind of look at some biblical principles that can help us out and still assure us to have a good and prosperous year. Now, of course, spiritual prosperity should always be our main focus. Yet today, I'm also going to be talking about every other aspect of our lives. But let me start by just asking you guys if any of you have set some goals for this for this year, some resolutions. I'm sure a lot of you have. Probably the most common resolution is losing some weight and getting back into shape again, which is always good. Although getting in shape and staying in shape seems to be a never-ending quest, especially for all us older people, since our metabolism is slowing down. And I mean, that's just made it a lot harder than it used to be for us. But still, looking good and feeling good, obviously, it's certainly worth the effort. Now, there's some other good resolutions. Could be maybe you want to quit smoking this year. Maybe you need to quit some other bad habits. How about working towards some financial prosperity? I mean, that's something that I know we could all use, as well as working on our relationships, our marriages, because that, of course, is of the utmost importance. But as your pastor, here is what I am hoping we're all shooting for, and that is that we all draw closer to our God this year. Amen? Because the thing with that is, if you want everything in life to just fall into place, then I'm telling you, drawing close to God, man, that's the ticket. That's the ticket. Because here's what the Bible said in Matthew chapter 6. And that is, Matthew chapter 6 says, above all, okay, or first and foremost, if we seek God and his righteousness, then every need in our lives will be taken care of. And to take it beyond that, well, in the Psalms, it says this. It says that if we fully commit to him, if we totally place our trust on our God and follow his principles, then not only will our needs be met, but our God will also give us the desires of our hearts. So basically, if we put God first in our lives, right, and I don't care what's going on in this crazy world around us, but if we do that, then 2023 can still be a great year. So making some resolutions this year is not a bad idea. It's not a bad idea. Because what it does is it creates for us kind of like a fresh start, right? It gives us an opportunity, a time to get, you know, refocused and redirected so that we can accomplish the things that are important to us. Now, unfortunately, as I think we all know, most resolutions fail because we just can't seem to stick to them. Now, of course, there's a lot of factors for that. Man, it is just so hard to stay focused long enough to accomplish anything because life is just so busy. Life is just so busy, and there's just so many distractions in our world today. In fact, never in the history of man has life been so busy, as we've all got just, you know, so many things going on that, I mean, it's like we don't know if we're coming or going. So it's just hard to keep our priorities straight. But another thing, and this is important, right? And that is that our lives get so burdened, right? I'm talking about spiritually burdened with the weight of so many things that we've collected, you know, through time. And chances are we're probably not even aware of it. But the results of all that is that spiritually, we come to the point where we can't even get out of our own way, right? Because that weight, it makes us weary and tired. And, yeah, we may have good intentions, but because of that heavy load, we have no endurance, right? It's like the spring in our step is gone. And I would assume there's a few of us here that can, you know, relate to that. Anyways, it's kind of like, you know, we know God. And we know who he is, and we still believe that we can do and accomplish all things through Christ. But yet it's like we just don't have the ambition and strength to lift our feet and move towards becoming the person that we know we should be. So it's like our Christian life is just stuck in the mud, right, in the miry clay. Okay, so what am I specifically talking about, right? What is it that weighs us down and causes us to get stuck in that proverbial rut of life? Well, there's a lot of things, all right? There's a lot of things. Things like worry, depression, loneliness, How about guilt and anger and hate and resentment, as well as our past failures and our past sins? Now, these are all things that we all experience, right? We all deal with all that stuff. But here's the thing, right? If we don't deal with this stuff when it comes around, but instead we allow it to stick around and exist, then it is going to weigh us down and it is going to hold us back and it will keep us from being all that we can be and from accomplishing our goals and our dreams. And here's where it can get actually scary, because the longer we keep this stuff around, then the higher the possibility that it can lead our lives into a place where we don't want to go. All right, what am I talking about? What do I mean by that? Well, Cain had anger on his mind before he had blood on his hands, right? The Pharisees killed Jesus in their hearts before they killed him on the cross. And that's how it works, people, right? Today's thoughts are tomorrow's actions, right? Today's anger is tomorrow's abuse, right? Today's bigotry is tomorrow's hate crime. Today's lust is tomorrow's adultery, right? Today's greed is tomorrow's theft. And so if we don't get rid of that stuff, then there is a good chance that it is going to create problems in our lives. And yeah, all those things I've just said, I mean, those are horrible things, yeah. But don't think that just because you're a Christian, it is not possible for you to fail God to that degree. Because just read your Bible, people, right? Just look at all the heroes of the faith. Because those very people that we look up to, well, many of them also failed God, right? Many of them failed God and committed great sins in his sight. And it was all because they allowed the wrong things to take root and exist in their lives. All right, let's just touch on a few of the common things. How about depression? Depression. Ultimately, where could that lead? Suicide, right? How about suicide? How many of us here have actually known someone who's committed suicide? Probably almost all of us, right? But here's the thing with that, right? You just don't wake up one day and decide that you're going to kill yourselves. But it is an accumulation of a lot of pain that was carried around and was never dealt with. Now, one of the crappy duties I had when I was a detective is that detectives had to always go on all the dead body calls, because we had to go there and determine if the death was by natural causes or if there was possibly some suspicious circumstances. Well, I went on this one suicide call where a young man had hung himself, and when I get there, he was lying face down on the floor, so I didn't recognize him. But when I reached in his pocket and pulled out his wallet to ID him, well, it was someone that I knew, and someone I knew very well, because it was actually one of the kids that was from my boxing gym. It was a kid named Jay, who was from the Job Corps Center. But what really hit me the hardest is, man, I thought this kid, I thought Jake had it all together, right? Because he was like a model student for the Job Corps, right? And at the gym, if I had to leave, he was actually the guy that I would always go to, and I would leave him in charge. And so I, you know, really took this really hard, because, again, I just thought I knew all these kids. I thought I knew all their problems. But apparently, Jake kept it all bottled up inside, and I guess he just, he thought he had no place to deposit all that pain, and sometimes it comes to the point where something's got to give. So please just recognize how serious that, you know, that stuff can be. Because when it comes to all these things that I've mentioned, we just cannot allow them to take root. Right? Because once they're there, what happens? Once we allow them into our lives, then the next thing is we're going to start to feed it, right? And anything we feed is going to grow. And so let me tell you, you know, if you think you feel bad now, well, hang on, because things are going to get worse. And man just seems to have a problem with that, a problem with just hanging on to that stuff. We get so caught up with our feelings and so caught up with the things in our past for some reason, we just can't let it go. Now, if that sounds like you, then I want you to remember what the Apostle Paul said in Philippians chapter 3, verse 13. And that is this. Paul said that the one thing I do is to forget those things which are behind. The one thing that I do is to forget those things that are behind. Well, think about it, right? Because that makes a whole lot of sense, because you know what? We can't change the past, can we? We cannot change the past, right? And that's why Paul then said this, right? And that is, instead, he said, instead, I reach forward to those things before me. Because maybe we can't change our yesterdays, but we all have certainly have something to say about our tomorrows. Amen? So, that's a possible remedy from Dr. Paul himself, right? And that is this. Let me just summarize it again. We need to let go of the things in our past that we can't change, and instead we need to focus on the things before us that we can change. Amen? We need to let go of the things in our past that we can't change, and instead we need to focus on the things before us that we can change. Because to entertain all those unfair and painful past experience, well, that is something that our joy and our peace and our relationship with our God cannot afford. Amen? All right. How about worry? That's another thing. That's something that we all deal with to some extent. Here's a good description. That is, worry is like a rocking chair. It gives you something to do, but it doesn't take you anywhere. Worry is like a rocking chair. It gives you something to do, but it doesn't take you anywhere. That's about it. Because how many times do we get all wound up and start worrying about something, but then it never comes to pass, right? Probably most of the time. Now, worry is not technically a disease, but it does affect our health, right? It's been linked to high blood pressure, heart trouble, blindness, migraines, all kinds of stomach disorders, right? So we're talking all kinds of bad stuff. But here's the worst thing that worry does, and that is what it does to us spiritually, right? And that is, it detracts from our faith. Because worry is obviously the opposite of faith, right? Because what it does is it demonstrates our lack of trust in our God. Anyways, all the stuff I mentioned, right, the stuff that we accumulate and hold on to in life, it is detrimental to our dreams and our success and our happiness. And most importantly, again, it's detrimental to our relationship with God. And so if we want to have a good and peaceful and even a prosperous year, right, and despite that discouraging outlook of the world around us, then, man, we got to unload that stuff. You know, and we've all got something that we've been carrying around a long time, but we've got to unload that. We've got to get rid of all that stuff that's weighing us down because, you know, and here's the best part of that. That stuff is not ours to carry, people. Here's what it says in 1 Peter 5:7. It tells us in 1 Peter 5:7 that we are to cast all our cares and worries on our God because he cares for us. And so by way of an invitation from Jesus himself, well, as he said in Matthew 11:28, Jesus said, "Come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest." I will give you rest. All right. Give it all to Jesus. Sounds easy, right? But I think we all know that it's not so easy, right? Turning things over to God, trusting in him fully, man, that's hard, right? That's some hard stuff. But when we do, right, when we're finally able to turn it over and give it to God, well, that is when the faithfulness of our God is going to be realized in our lives, right? And that's when we will become free to really enjoy our life to the fullest. And again, regardless of what's going on around us. Now, by example, there was a lunatic by the name of Mike Hale who shared his testimony at one of our services. Now, this was quite a few years ago, so I'm thinking that most of you here probably weren't around. But Mike was actually the bass player for the Posse Band back when the Salvation Saloon was just starting out. Now, Mike also had this fatal disease, and within a year or two, it had, you know, quickly progressed to its final stages. But here's what happened during that time that compelled Mike to give his testimony to all his brothers and sisters here at the saloon, and that is that as his health was failing, well, he came to this point where he was just overwhelmingly consumed with all the stress and the fear of facing his own mortality. And it came to the point where he just could not bear it anymore, right? And so what's he do? He's at his house. He's all by himself, and he just drops to his knees, and he cries out to his God. Now, he had been praying all along, obviously, but this time, right, this time, this prayer was one of total desperation and surrender, because he knew there was absolutely no hope at this point outside of God. And so he starts praying. Immediately, he said God spoke to him and kind of reminded him of a sermon that I just recently preached. And it was a sermon, which is much like the one you're hearing today, because it was about casting our cares on our God. And so here he was. He's all alone in his house. He's at his breaking point. He's got tears running down his face, and he just cried out to his God, and he said, Lord, you got to take this. You got to take it, because I just can't handle it anymore. And this is what he told us that happened. He said instantly he felt all that fear and anxiety. He felt it just lift off of him, right? And it was immediately replaced with this overwhelming feeling of peace. And he said that it was so dramatic and so real that it freaked him out, right? Because he had never experienced anything like this before. Anyways, from there, as he continued to speak to the congregation, well, he went on just to give glory to God. And his testimony, I mean, it really encouraged all of us. Now, a couple months after that, after he had given his testimony, Mike was given this opportunity to go to the Mayo Clinic in Kansas City, because that was the facility that specialized in his disease. And so, you know, he's really feeling blessed. He's feeling excited. He's even hopeful that, you know, they might possibly be able to do something like, you know, maybe ease his symptoms, maybe prolong his life. So, you know, he was kind of excited about that, and we were all excited about that. So he ends up going, and after a couple days of testing, well, this is what they told him. They said, hey, Mike, by the way, you also found that you got kidney cancer. All right, well, you would think that would certainly deflate a guy's faith. But Mike, after this took place, Mike got on the phone, he gave me a call, and this is what he said. He said, Paul, when they told me that, it didn't even faze me. He said it was like whatever, right? Because that unexplainable peace, it was still there. It was still there, right? And he was just totally content, because he knew that his God, you know, had him in his hands, had it under control. Now, tell me if that is not the peace that passes all understanding that God has promised us in his word. Amen? I mean, that's crazy. And man, when you see that come alive like in your life, or you see it come alive in someone else's life, then how can you deny that our God is truly alive and well on this planet? Amen? He is still here to see us through anything that this life can throw our way. And that even includes death, which Mike faced shortly thereafter. But, as it tells us in the 23rd Psalm, right, tells us that even though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we will fear no evil, because we know that our God is with us. So here's what we got to do in this coming year, right, in 2023. We got to trust in our God, right? We've got to trust in him to take the things that we've been carrying around and weighing us down and holding us back, and we've got to turn them over to him. And so this year, that means we need to seek him first. We need to give it to God. We need to allow him to be the priority of our life, right? Or as it says in Hebrews, we'll need to fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, right? Because that is the path that we need to follow if we are going to live a good life in this crazy world, right? Because face it, people, there's just some places that we can't go, right? And there are some thoughts that we just cannot stand to entertain. Because again, our joy and our peace and our relationship with God, you can't afford to go there. You can't afford to go there. And really, we should all know that by experience, because I think the truth is for most of us is that, you know, the many battles that we have fought in the past, well, they were fought in places that we never should have been at. But when we are doers of God's word and not hearers only, well, that is when God's will for our lives is going to be realized. All right, what is his will? What's God's will? What is God's plan for our lives? Well, as God declared in Jeremiah chapter 29, he said this. He said, I know the plans I have for you, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. God says, I know the plans I have for you, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. So what's our future going to look like in this coming year? Well, I pray that God blesses and prospers us all in this new year. But again, let's not forget that we play a pretty important role in that as well. Amen? And again, that is, we need to seek our God first, right? Our God needs to come first above all else. And that is my sermon for today. And I hope it made sense, and I hope it's been helpful. But go home and pray about it, and see how God leads you. See what God tells you as far as what you need to get out of your life. What have you been carrying around and you need to be set free of? Go home and pray about it and seek God first. And I guarantee you this could be one of the best years of your life. Amen? All right. I love you guys. Love you guys so much. And I pray he blesses you this week, and I pray he again that he blesses you in this coming year. And I'm going to turn things over to Katie, who's going to come up and close.
That was very inspirational, hey? For a happy new year, big start. I wanted to just remind y'all that, you know, everything that's seen around us is temporary. It's, you know, it can be gone and blown in the wind. So we need to focus on what is unseen, because what is unseen is eternal. And that's inside us, and that's our eternity. That's our promise with God. So I wanted to say a prayer today. If you've never asked God into your life, I want you to pray with me and see if we can do it now, because this is going to be a great year for all of us. If you bow your heads, please. Dear God, I don't have all the answers, but I know you do. So from this point on, I want to rely on you by accepting Jesus as my Lord and Savior. So please forgive me, make all things new, and by the power of your grace, I will now seek to follow you and to serve you all the days of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. And go out and have a great day. Bucks are playing today, and the fog should be lifted by now for us out on the highway. Have a great day, and I'll see you all next week. Okay?